All right, well, let's go now to the ongoing safety concerns gripping Qantas, being forced to confront worried passengers following mid-air troubles with 6 flights in the past 2 weeks. That's despite reclaiming the title of world's safest airline for 2023.
So today, CEO Alan Joyce is making a promise to customers that Qantas has a strong safety culture and airfare prices will soon come down. He joins us now. Good morning to you, Alan. How are you? Welcome back.
Good morning, Karl. Yeah, Happy New Year. We can keep on saying that to you.
Yeah, thank you. Well, it hasn't been the happiest of New Year's, has it? Look, a string of incidents. Is it a run of bad luck, or could some of these issues have been avoided?
Well, Carol, first of all, I would say that air turnbacks are really rare. We have 1 in 2,000 Qantas flights, but they're more common than a lot of your viewers would actually think. Qantas, even before COVID, had around 50 or so a year. Qantas Link, 200 a year. Jetstar, 80 a year. In fact, worldwide, there's over 10,000 a year that occurs. And they are a very important part of the safety management system. You know, an aircraft has up to 4 million moving parts. There are redundant systems on it. But when something goes wrong, a pilot will often look at, is it the best thing to do is to turn back and get that issue fixed? I really applaud our pilots when they do this, and I really encourage them to keep on doing it. We have the best pilots in the world. They're doing a fantastic job. And in fact, Carl, you know, in the month of January, that isn't actually the highest month of turnbacks that we've ever had. Before COVID, we had a couple of months that were higher than that. And we do have, they happen in spades. We do have months where there's 0, 1 or 2. We have months for Qantas where there are 8, 9 and 10. There were 8 for Qantas in the month of January. Not too dissimilar than Virgin. Virgin had a very similar number on their 737 fleet. So it's a common thing, but very rare. It's actually very rare, but more common than people would think.
I think Virgin are saying this morning they've had half the number.
And so you've got Qantas with 2 different things. You've got Qantas with its mainline fleet. And actually what happened with Qantas' 737 fleet, we had 6 in the month of January. And I believe that there were 8 on Virgin 737 fleet during that month. In the Qantas Link fleet, which goes into regional ports, it's very different because regional ports often don't have engineers. Mm. Regional ports often don't have, can have bad weather where the instruments are not the same. But I would say there's nothing wrong with air turnbacks. Mm. They're an important part of the safety management system. They're inconvenient for customers, and I apologise for it. I wish for customers there weren't any. But you should be worried about the airlines that don't do the turn back, not the airlines that do. It's a very important of the safety management system. And again, I'd encourage all of the airlines in Australia to keep on doing what they're doing. It's making the aviation industry in this country one of the safest in the world. And that's really important that we continue that trend.
I don't think we want people wondering why their plane hasn't turned back though, Alan. But hey, look, there's always a grace period that we'll allow for, right, given COVID and the challenges that posed. But have the issues that we're seeing at the moment got anything to do with the various redundancies that you made during that period?
No, and I would say that what we're seeing now is that, like the entire aviation industry, we had problems 6 months ago. And we've seen those problems improve over that period of time. Every week they've gotten better. And on our operational performance now in January, in some cases it was better than pre-COVID, and a lot of cases it was the same as pre-COVID. Our on-time performance is now better at 82% nearly in January, 5 months ahead of Virgin in a row. Our cancellation levels are the same as pre-COVID, our mishandled bags the same, and our call centre a lot better. And what we are seeing is that we are getting more and more of our aircraft back in the air. At some areas like engineering, we're the only airline that does its heavy maintenance. 90% of our heavy maintenance is done here in Australia. If it's important for you to have heavy maintenance done in Australia, Qantas is the only carrier you should be flying with. And we haven't changed anything in engineering compared to where it was before COVID.
Look,
and you had the head of the engineering union actually supporting the fact that these turnbacks are not an issue and that the trends that we are seeing is no different than we had before COVID.
Look, I spent some time there too behind the just terrific engineers and the maintenance people. I'm very hardworking people. I don't think you'd find anyone in Australia who has a problem with Qantas' safety record. Let's move on though. Airfare prices. These are some of the popular routes one way, for example, at the moment domestically. Sydney to Brisbane, $198. Melbourne to the Gold Coast is $304. When do you think those prices will come down outside of sales?
So, Carl, what's happening now is that every airline around the globe is getting its capacity back in the air. So by the middle of the year, this year on international, we'll be back to 80% of our pre-COVID capacity. China's opening up, Japan's opening up, and we are already seeing airfares come down. But there's a couple of reasons why airfares are high. First of all is inflation, and that hasn't changed. We've had 3 years of inflation. You've seen it everywhere. And for us, the big inflation element is fuel. It's up nearly 65% on pre-COVID levels, and that's our biggest cause. And that is passed on in the airfares. But there's some unbelievably low airfares out there. We have a sale of 170,000 international airfares at the moment, 1,699 from Melbourne to London return, 1,299 from Sydney to LA return. And domestically, if you plan well in advance, you can get Jetstar airfares of $50, Qantas airfares between Melbourne and Sydney of under $150. Certainly, what you see in peak periods is there's a lot more demand, and those airfares sell out a lot faster.
Okay, just generally speaking, because I think people are fascinated by this, and the Australian appetite for travel is beyond what it's ever been. Yep. When will they even out outside of the sale periods, do you reckon? And whereabouts will they even out to?
And much more competition.
I think that's already happened. We have one of the most competitive markets in the world. You already now have Bonza starting, Rex operating, and Virgin. So we've had never had as much competition domestically, and you're seeing a lot cheaper airfares coming onto the system. Okay. Internationally, we're competing against hundreds of carriers, and it's all about getting these supply chain issues, Carl, right. As I said, we're back to 80% of our pre-COVID capacity by the middle of the year. Most of our competitors are back slightly below that, but as everybody gets the aircraft back in the air, airfares come down, and that's happening very rapidly.
All right, you've got the Qantas back in the black. Things look like they're on the right path. It sounds like a great swan song. When are you flying off into the sunset to sip pina coladas for the rest of your life, Alan?
Well, Carl, I'm very passionate, as you know, about Qantas, as you are. And I think it's an amazing company, amazing brand. And I'm here to make sure that it gets out of this pandemic crisis back to where it was. If anything, we want it to be a lot better. And we have some exciting things happening that I'm very excited about. We have a new aircraft arriving on average every month this year. And for the next 6 years, on average every 3 weeks, we've got huge announcements happening on Qantas lounges.
He's not going anywhere.
It's like a walking pamphlet.
And we've got Project Sunrise. We've got Project Sunrise happening, which is going to lead the aviation industry. I'm so excited about all of that.
We might change it.
We'll change it next year to Project Today for a while.
That's
How
it.
About that?
Good on you, Alan. Nice to see you, mate. Thank you so much. It's been a turbulent and deadly start to 2023, hasn't it, for our aviation industry? Four people killed on January 2 when two helicopters collided mid-air on the Gold Coast. It was on the 18th a Qantas flight from Auckland to Sydney was forced to make a mayday call when the Boeing 737 lost one of its engines.
Just a day later, another mid-flight incident for the Flying Kangaroo, with a flight forced to turn around due to a mechanical fault. A week later, a seaplane crashed off the Queensland coast shortly after takeoff. Those on board lucky to be alive.
And on the 29th of January, a Qantas Link flight from Sydney to Coffs Harbour had to turn around due to a landing gear issue.
Investigating all of these incidents and more is the Australian Transport Safety Bureau, and we're pleased to say the Bureau's Chief Commander, Angus Mitchell, joins us live now. Good to be with you. Thank you so much for joining us today, Angus.
Thank
you
for having me.
It's been a busy few weeks. How concerned are you by this spate of incidents we've seen in such a short period of time?
Look, it has been busy really from Boxing Day onwards, but equally we had a very busy year last year across all of aviation. And whilst there is certainly heightened sensitivity at the moment, and particularly for the big passenger carrying, and that is really our focus, we aren't seeing statistically that things are that much different than they were pre-COVID. Now, that's not to say that the individual incidents aren't very serious, and we've got around about 100 active investigations, but equally, we look at all of them individually. And if they do tell us that there's a trend, well, then we start looking at the trends. That trend's not emerging at the moment, but there are some, as you mentioned, some very serious incidents.
So we went behind the scenes at Qantas with maintenance, and they've obviously got a pedigree like no other airline in the world. But when you do get a succession of things, and let's face it, they've all landed safely, but when you do get a succession of things, do you take a closer look at behind the scenes?
Look, we do. We know that that whole industry is stressed at the moment, and that's not just at the big end of town, that's also regional and rural aviation as well. And a lot of that is post-COVID, and that's supply chains of parts, that's having enough licensed aircraft mechanics, and particularly in regional areas, that is something that is quite acute at the moment. But it also
Is it acute, dangerous acute?
No, that doesn't necessarily mean... What it means is that at the moment there is a specific point of time where there are different stresses than there perhaps was pre-COVID.
Right.
And we see that, and that goes from baggage handling to security to that whole supply chain, all of which do have an impact on safety, or they have a role to play. But we're certainly seeing that whilst there's been a very quick recovery out of COVID in terms of getting flying up, all of those other things are lagging to a degree, and that doesn't make it unsafe. Our job, whilst we do have one of the most enviable safety records in the world, the ATSB's job is to make sure that it's not just a record, that we're looking forward and we're looking at what are the stresses now, what do we see from our investigations, and what are the recommendations in terms of how can we make it and keep our record the way that it is at the moment.
And that's the thing, obviously flights are filling up more these days than they have been in the past few years, so there is a bit of concern out there from the public. I mean, how do we maintain our sort of assurance that we are in safe hands?
Well, and that's why we have an independent investigative body, which is the ATSB, so that we do have, we have very considerable powers when it comes to gathering evidence. And we do that, as I said, we've got 100 active investigations. We release around 60 reports a year. Last year, I think we had about 56 safety recommendations. So those safety issues is when we identify something that could have been improved or that had a contributing element to an accident, then we go to the operator, the maintainer, the manufacturer, whoever owns it, and we work with them to say, what are you doing to fix that? And we had 56 of them last year.
OK, we've been talking this morning about the SeaWorld tragedy. Obviously, 60 Minutes has a brilliant story, which gives us some insight into what it was like on board. From an investigative point of view, where are you at with that investigation, and how are you putting these pieces together?
So we have very distinct phases of our investigation. The first one is gathering evidence. And I said we do have very considerable powers. Now, that evidence is what we get on scene, and it's going through the two cabins involved. We've got about 90 witness statements. We've got well over a dozen video points of view from buildings, from inside both the helicopters. We're stitching all that together to get a much better appreciation of what occurred on that day. Did it differ from other flights? And we go back over months of flights of these in that particular operator. What was different on this day? When we find particularly catastrophic accidents like this, it's never one single thing. It's generally, there's a range of things that have lined up. And whether that's maintenance, whether that's fatigue, whether that's the visibility, whether that's sun, there's a whole range of things for us to do.
You have so much more technology at your disposal these days. Is there anything you're doing differently in this Gold Coast investigation?
Well, we're certainly, and you're right, we do have a lot of technology there. So we've had some drones up there this week flying the flight paths of those two helicopters. We're now reconstructing what was seen from both pilot, from one of the other helicopters up there that was similar to the two involved in the collision. So we'll get a much better picture of, I guess, of the totality of that evidence. What we don't do is look at one piece of evidence and then come up with a theory. We spend a couple of months gathering all of that evidence, then we come up with a number of hypotheses and we run those by all of the evidence. And it's either supported by the evidence or not. So it is a lengthy process, but it's to get a safe outcome at the end that we can not only determine what occurred, but what was the circumstances that allowed it to occur? And most importantly, what can we do to make sure it doesn't reoccur?
Everyone wants answers, don't they?
Absolutely.
Imagine what you could do at the ATSB with a bit more government funding, I'm sure.
Well,
that would assist.
Handy, wouldn't it?
It's all around trying to get what's going to get the greatest public benefit. And certainly, large passenger carrying is at the top of our list, but equally charter flights like we saw up there as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate all
Thank
that.
Thank you.